This is the launch of the SIDSE HVAC Systems Special Interest Group. And my name is Tony Day, and for my sins I've been kind of co-opted to chair this, Special Interest Group, which for me is a very exciting thing to be doing, because I used to teach at London South Bank University, and before that I was a hospital engineer, and I used to crawl in and out of cooling towers and change filters and scrub things clean. So I've known HVAC systems from the inside out, and now here we are. But I know people are wondering, why on earth do we need, why does SIDSE need an HVAC special interest group? And I see some nods and some knowing smiles over there. Well, so what is the purpose of this group? Why does SIDSE need it? Isn't that the raison d'etre for SIDSE? Well, SIDSE used to be the HVAC. That's what it was: heating and ventilating and air conditioning. But it's much broader than that now. So building services encompass a whole other range of systems and services and options. So we actually need to get back to basics, I think, and focus on the core, some of these core systems. We overlook the fact that these some of the most complicated systems in our buildings, they're probably underperforming. We may not be designing, like, how many of you designers out there? We may not be designing them as well as we could be. I don't think they're being operated as well as they might. So the HVAC systems is special interest group is now to bring together that plethora of, that wealth of knowledge that we have across the sector, and to look not just at integrating the heating, ventilating and air conditioning systems as a systems thinking approach, but also in time, the longitudinal, the whole life of operation of a building. So it's about this design supply chain, design and operation supply chain. And when you think about how many actors there are and how many moving parts there are in designing, putting to work a building and then operating it over its lifetime, this is extremely complex. It's a huge challenge to say these complex systems are always going to work and perform. So what we want to do is get systems that will perform over the lifetime and do what they're supposed to do at the outset. So it's not about how much energy they use, but it's about the services that they deliver for that energy. So we have three speakers today who are going to talk about how we do it well. And so I'll just briefly introduce them, and then they're going to speak for 5 minutes each. And then we're going to open up to questions from the floor so we can have a bit of a discussion. So we have Debbie Hobbs from Legal & General. We have Ashley Bateson, Hawley, and we have Phil Draper from Broadgate Estates. So we have a client specification perspective, we have a designer perspective, and we have an end user perspective. And each of them, I think, are going to probably, whether they stick to their brief or not, I have no idea. But they've got 5 minutes really to say, what do we do well? But perhaps start to tease at the edges of, actually, what are we not doing so well, and what are we going to get better? And that, maybe that will start to answer some of the questions about actually why we need this group and bringing in a whole range of new members to start to answer some of these difficult questions. So I'm going to hand over, and I think Debbie is going to talk first and give us the design specification, the client side perspective. Thank you.
Okay, hi everybody. I've got 5 minutes, so I should be as controversial as I can in 5 minutes. So I now work at Legal & General Property. We've got £20 billion worth of property in the UK, but I'm a SIDSE engineer by background, and I worked at Trane Controls for a while. I've worked with AECOM, and I've worked in many aspects of the industry. So I arrived 5 years ago and found 42 air-conditioned multi-let offices, and I wondered why 39 of them didn't even have the time clock set up properly, let alone the controls, why they were heating and cooling all year round simultaneously, why the valves were turned into fully open, why the pumps were put into fixed speed when they were variable, why there wasn't really any maintenance being done, and why they were losing hundreds of thousands of pounds worth of cost for our tenants. So my passion is about getting buildings performing well, and we definitely don't do that in the UK. The one thing we know is that in the UK, the same buildings in Australia, with very different climatic conditions, you could argue more cooling, needing more energy, perform at half the energy performance they do in the UK, because we don't focus on it. So what we do well is we spend an awful lot of money and an awful lot of time talking about and then designing buildings. We spend a bit more time constructing them, a little tiny bit of time if you're lucky commissioning them, and then we give it over to some people like Phil and say, by the way, can you make them work now, please? Now you've got different occupants and they've changed everything around and messed them up. Could you just make it work, please? So I guess my reason for joining this group is I think we need to rethink HVAC systems in buildings and work out how we make them usable, flexible, and fit for purpose in the future. And the thing that really bugs me at the moment as an institution investor is we never put opening windows in. So we run cooling and we run heating and we never have any mix mode. We don't need all this HVAC. So here's my challenge. What are we going to do with it?
Excellent.
We're going to hand over to Ashley, who's a designer, who's going to follow on from here.
That's a great challenge. And Tony said we're going to talk about what the industry is good at. I've got one thing to say. I think the building services industry is good at designing to standards, and I think we're good at designing for compliance. That's that out of the way. Can I say some of the motives for joining the CIPSEA HVAC group are opportunities to do better. So I've got three things to focus on. So I think we design for compliance well, I think we're good at researching standards and helping to build up standards. But it's some of the broader system thinking that was actually picked up in one of the preliminary meetings of the HVAC group, is that we need more system thinking. And an example of that was, as Debbie said, about how does the window interact with the comfort systems that the engineer's designing. So I think if engineers are psychologists, architects, interior designers, and good with people, and can design all the systems to standards, we'll have a fantastic building. So there's a lot of awareness of the intricacies of integrated building design that are opportunities for engineers. Another issue is, I think engineers are quite good at taking instructions, but sometimes they don't know who to take the instructions from. So who's the client? So the people that designed this building, who was the client for this building? Was it the property developer? Was it the end user? Who weren't there in the briefing session? Was it the building manager that we're designing for? Was it the legacy of the environmental impact we were designing for? So I think there's a lot of sort of client questions where we're probably good at dealing with instructions from one aspect of a client, but if there's a multi-headed client, then that's something that we need to balance. And all these are opportunities. And just and then the last point, I think this all culminates on the handover process. So designers are appointed generally to construction completion and have invoiced for most of their work, if not all of it, let's say 100%. And the contractors, the designers, the architects then hand over the keys. And I've been in situations where I said, I don't think the building's ready to occupy. The building management system hasn't been properly commissioned. Then you're under pressure. The contract administrator says, but is it fit to occupy? Well, the lifts work and the fire alarms have been tested, but the meters haven't been calibrated and the building management system still hasn't been verified. So you're under pressure and then we hand over. So I think there's a lovely journey from who's the client to handover and then building operation. So Phil Draper from Colgate. Thank you very much.
Hi everyone. So first of all, thank you Ashley for leading that in nicely, that or picking up the rubbish, we'll go for that term. The big problem we get in the industry is taking that non-completed item and putting it right without upsetting the new end client. You can imagine taking some of these very large buildings where you've got some of the biggest social media companies now we deal with, and trying to put a building right without telling them that it's wrong in the first place. But ultimately, without doing without any money. And that's always the hard bit. For a building, you don't get to spend money on making it better until 5-6 years after completion. So how do you fix the meter on a service charge that is very, very tight, especially in today's world, without having the money to spend it? Or trying to get in the competency in the in-house staff, and the term engineer here is probably very debatable in terms of how many are working actually on buildings today, in terms of getting it to fix. You know, I've had a background, the same sort of thing as Tony, of being onto the tools, being manufacturing backgrounds, understand how to operate things, how to work things. I'm lucky. Most of the people in today's world have rolled off of a production line to a degree, they know how to change a lamp, but they've got that term engineer. And all of a sudden we're asking these people about the background, about the skills, to fix things they don't understand. Sometimes they make it worse. And I think that's the key thing we need to pick up in today's world, is trying to get the right people in the right place. I think Debbie said before today around the term the engineer, you know, they've got to be in the right place to fix it. But if you start putting a true engineer on a service charge, all of a sudden you're putting £100,000 on top of it for what is 3 hours a year of engineering time. So it's all about relationships. So the key thing that I believe in is passion and trying to make things better. But trying to actually on a positive note, it can be done. I've got buildings that are built, you know, by some of the design by some of the biggest consultants in the UK, not to mention names. And they work wonderfully. No complaints from the occupiers, all great, service charge is good. But since then I've managed to knock 95% of the gas bill. I've managed to knock 70% actually off the common parts energy by optimising it. No big expensive spends. A few tweaks, get the building optimised, time clocks working, but also working with the occupier. What do they really need? Because no one actually asks them. The mindset over a lease, 7 till 7. You ask the question to most of my occupiers, where are you at 6 o'clock? I'm at home. But you still want your air conditioner on, full belt, at 22 degrees or up, you know, 25 degrees for the heat inside, come 7 o'clock at night. Why? Because it's in our lease. Why? Why does it matter? So it's all about occupier engagement and using today's technology to put it right. I think I'll stop there.
To questions and comments from the audience there and for our speakers. But I just want to add in a little anecdote, because as I was listening to that, I remember one of the last jobs I was a client on, I'd specified some heat metering goes in so we could run a research project, had to be at a university, on some heat pumps. And we put in, at great expense, these heat meters, and they were supposed to be compliant and all the rest of it. After 2 years of saying this data is rubbish, we went back to the person who installed the meters, and we discovered actually most of the sensors were put in the wrong place, which begged the question of how was it commissioned. But eventually the guy said, you never told me at the start that you wanted accurate information from these meters. I mean, I was speechless, and I'm still speechless about that. But so that kind of says that somewhere in the design specification, we didn't say specifically, this has got to work properly. I mean, or it's got to give me something that's of value. I don't. It's not just for show. And then it's got to be, somehow we've got to join up the dots at the end. From what Phil's saying is that you know, you don't really have the money to put things right as soon as the project's been handed over. So you as the end client are kind of left with what you're given, and there's very little you can do about it. So I think that these start to raise big questions about the integration that we talked about of the system, but the whole of the technical system, but of the process, the design system, the design to operation system, and looking into the future. So with that in mind, just to flag up, on the 24th of January, we've got our first special interest group event, which will be in London at all the offices at King's Cross, which will be the future of commissioning. So I think that's we've just highlighted there, this gap, this chasm between design, installation, commissioning, setting to work. So we've got four great speakers lined up for that. One of them should be here, Jeff, he's going to talk about it. Jeff is going to talk about, I think, that whole leadership thing of how you design things or specify things. So that's just the advertisement for the next event that's coming up. I would suggest to all of you go onto this website and become members of the group and put yourselves forward as members of the group so you can get involved in what's going on. With that, questions for our speakers, please.
Yes. Can I suggest a new name for the group? Delivering the label that is on the tin. And actually, that's in a nutshell what we're trying to do. And I wonder, in a sense, if the panel could respond to the fact that we're arguably moving into a world where the end consumer rules okay. And just like VW have had their scandal for not delivering what's on the label on the tin, are we going to move away from code compliance and tick the box in each of the little segments through to actually does it work, and you are judged as designers and so forth on whether it works, not whether you've ticked the box? I'm interested in your comments.
Okay, I'll start. From the world of property, I think the interesting thing is people like WeWork, who are coming in to disrupt the property sector by changing the way leases work and offering people flexible space they can just turn up to and work where they want. They don't like that office they were working in today, they can go somewhere else tomorrow. So it's going to be about occupier satisfaction. So the BCO have just produced the occupier satisfaction work that Real Service have been doing with them. There's going to be a lot more occupier satisfaction that's going to be scored. So if you go to a building, a WeWork site, and you like it, you'll go on your iPhone, you'll give it a good star rating. If not, you'll give it a bad star rating, and slowly that will affect the value of building. So I think technology and occupier satisfaction is going to start disrupting things, and it won't be about compliance anymore. So I'm going to pass over to Ashton.
Yeah, thanks. It should all be about performance, really, shouldn't it? And I was trying to... You had another name for the group, but I couldn't write down the acronym quick enough, so I don't know what that... I think we're already seeing changes because of the democratisation of data and the access to data. So we've now got £200 air quality monitoring devices, and we're monitoring a number of offices, and we've already found really interesting things so far. So rooms that clients thought were mechanically ventilated were not at all. There were grills in the ceiling, but they were never connected. So we've been able to say, right, the air quality is bad, the carbon dioxide is going up every time you have a meeting. We did an investigation quite easily and showed that there was no mechanical ventilation. And that all came about because people are able to easily access data now. So I think we are at the beginning of a trend. People will start to have more occupancy satisfaction, more interest in health and well-being. And we did a survey in one of our offices, and people said they are really interested in environmental performance of their own office. So I think hopefully those measurable indices will drive this agenda.
I think the key thing that's going to come out of this is the smart building side of life, and what does that really mean for us? Ultimately, the education around that. The whole point around smart, what does this mean? But currently, this is like an acronym that people go, I want a smart building. But no one actually looks at the end usage. Part of that is teaching our occupiers and our clients, whether or not actually the property owner, the person inside it, what do they actually want, what do they have? Until we start educating them over what their needs are, we're not going to get anywhere, because all of a sudden they're likely going to get in a Bentley car, but tell you what, they don't want to pay for a Ford. So until we start telling them what they can have and what's available, they're going to keep on wishing away and comparing themselves against something they can't compare themselves with.
Clients don't know anything about building services, and the development managers I work with are generalists. You know, they've built a lot of buildings and they know their time and budget and they'll do their financial appraisal and they pretty much know how to get the contractual chain set up. But they don't really understand. You know, they can't understand why we can't deliver a metering system that works. They just assume they ask when they get one. But then they don't know they didn't really ask for it in the first place because it wasn't in the contract. So right at the end of the project, it suddenly comes out they didn't even specify it in the first place. So there's a lot's got to be done to educate clients, almost like a checklist that you can't start a building, you can't go for planning unless a client has completed this checklist about the building. And then the client will have to. And the other thing is, in Australia, the reason their buildings perform really well is they have a NABERS rating. And the NABERS rating from the design has to be delivered in operation. Otherwise, the landlord has to refund the tenant money. Now, if we can get that working in the UK, says she, working for a landlord, then we might actually focus on getting the buildings operating for our tenants as well.
All right, thank you very much. I will just say that this idea that the client, I think the problem here is they don't know what they don't know. So the education of the client actually is pretty key here. So in Rumsfeldian terms, it's the unknown unknowns. But I would like to throw in the unknown knowns, because we know a lot of stuff out there, but we don't put them together. We don't know what we each know. So it's about synergy and bringing everything together to bring us the known knowns. Tim, I think you had a question.
Yeah. Tim Dwyer from UCL. I struggle to see where the problem lies, really. I mean, the stories we heard are very amusing, but I went to one of Jeff's seminars 10 years ago, and I heard the same stories then about lights being left on in Canary Wharf when people weren't there. You know, we're the professionals. You know, if I go to a healthcare professional, I haven't set out what I want from a healthcare profession. I go to him because I'm ill, and he sorts out, or she sorts out, what needs doing. Now, for us to turn around and say, well, it's up to the client to tell us what they want, we're the professional, surely we should be leading it. I just wonder where the real gap is. Is it because we've lost our confidence and we won't push our ideas forward? Is it because we're incompetent and we can't push our ideas forward? Or is it because there's a knowledge gap and we don't know how to push our ideas forward? Where's the problem? And how's it going to be solved with the HVAC group's activities?
Well, a different set of unknown unknowns. So.
I think it is a knowledge gap, and that's about post-occupancy evaluation. The point I made earlier about engineers and contractors feeling the job is done at practical completion, the whole contractual arrangement judges completion when you hand over the keys instead of the beginning of a journey. So there is, I think, more of a desire for post-occupancy evaluation. Sometimes you have to do it for free because clients don't want to pay for somebody to check that what they've designed is working properly. So I think if we do more post-occupancy evaluation, then we gain the knowledge to know that there were some decisions we made in the design and procurement that have hampered the performance. So I just think the whole industry at the moment has a procurement framework that doesn't really give the feedback loop. So whether we can change that procurement role is something we need to challenge.
I think Tony and Ashley both touched on it, that one of the things that I think we're hoping this group will do is not just focus on the bit that SIBs do in the middle and the M&E engineers. It's looking at having manufacturers, having FM companies and having clients on all sit together to say, right, how are we going to make sure that in use this building is going to perform to what somebody wants it to. Now, is it the occupier or is it the client? The client just wants to get it built on time at a certain price with a certain net lettable area, rented at a certain value. That's what they want. So they didn't even care, really, what's in there. But the occupier will, but the client doesn't know what they're going to care about. So there's a lot of conversations to be had to try and help everybody understand how this could work so much better, I think.
I think the point you made over where does the problem lie, I think it lies with everyone. Actually, it lies with the client, actually not being advised, but also not asking the question, not doing their own research. It lies with the engineer, not making the client aware that it's an alternative to a gas boiler, or it's an alternative actually to how a chiller could work. And actually then it comes down to the end user, not then feeding that back up through the chain of actually, it didn't work. This is how we fixed it. And actually go back to the client. Part of what I do with Broadgate Estates, I sit on a design and management sort of team, and we go to our clients, when it's come out of the ground, sort of stage two, and I get about 30 looks from engineers when I suggest putting a heat pump in. They go, a heat pump will never work. Shall I show you one, they say? And all of a sudden they look dumbfounded that I've made a reverse cycle heat pump work in a 2001 building. And all of a sudden the client goes, why would you not tell about this? And the engineer says, we didn't ask. And that's where part of the problem lies.
Could I just say,
Mike, I blame the educators. Right? Tim, you're at UCL, Tony.
Not anymore.
You used to be at London South Bank. People are coming out of colleges with no interest or knowledge of how buildings perform. So it stops at college. That's the educators have let us down.
I agree, but I see some former students sitting in the audience. Was it all that bad? No. I agree with you, because it is difficult. You're teaching for design, but you have to teach for operation as well, and that is. And Jeff would attest to this. I think that's more difficult to train people into that operational practice, which is to trying to deliver. There's a question here, Richard. But 1 second, I'll just make the point that Debbie made. It's about supply chains, manufacturers, designers, contractors, commissioners, the client, the end user, the whole thing. How do you join that? How do you have a conversation? Because those supply chains, they don't often talk to each other. And the research that I run a research centre in Ireland, where we try and set up supply chain research projects, because the idea there is you've got a guaranteed route to market by the end of the research project, and everybody talks to each other. But what we've learned is that the manufacturer and the end user do not even speak the same language, they don't even know they're on the same planet, they never communicate. So actually, we need to do that, and not just in the building services industry, but I think across a lot of technical supply chains, is get the whole manufacturer to end user supply chain working conversing together, so we actually know how it's joined up together. Systems thinking in its best form, and we have to add the educator into that supply chain. So there's a question just here.
Thank you. Andreas, Carreras. I was just thinking about the way building regs work in terms of designing buildings. So we seem to be aiming for a theoretical target. Whereas we should be from the beginning aiming for an operational one, which can be consulted with the prospective occupier. Is that something that the group would be aiming to do? Changing the racks and that?
Okay, that's, I think it's going to be our second event next year. So it's all going to be about how we design buildings and predict performance and then measure against performance, rather than for compliance and Part L and EPCs and all the rest of the theoretical stuff. But the client's got to pay for that up front. So if you want to know the performance of your building, you want to predict it, you have to put it in your design phase. Not a huge amount compared to what you're paying your architect, but it's a pretty good facade on the front. So people are going to have to understand where they're getting value out of the client side. But equally, if it's a client, you're then going to operate the building and pay back money to the tenants when it's not performing, you're probably going to spend that extra 30 or 40 grand in the design team.
So there is that design for performance initiative looking at the kilowatt hours. I think the building regulations will always have to look at a design measure, because I think it will be difficult to enforce a regulation to change it. So it's probably the best principle is to have a constructed certification. But it's useful for the industry to look at kilowatt hours as a measure of success otherwise. And maybe already CIPSE links performance awards to performance reputation. So I don't think it can be a regulatory or planning challenge. It's more of a client pull, I think, operational outcome.
Any more questions? Yeah. Chris has a supplementary, I think. Yeah.
So should designers be paid on results?
No.
I knew I was going to say that. I think the problem we're going to get is that, unfortunately, clients do very strange things with buildings. So we design them in all sorts of different ways, shell and core, cat A, cat A and cat B. We let tenants come in and mess them up, cut cables, turn off the metering, put in air conditioning, you know, units all over the place to counteract what was there. So it's going to be very hard. But I think if you look at the NAMERS model, where everybody's working together to try and achieve the same rating, at least along the chain, everybody's going to have the discussion of how this is going to affect that end rating. And even if it's just, as a client, we said, right, I want an office building performing at 100 kilowatt hours per square a year, and then everybody focused on it. It would at least start the debate rather than I want an office building that will let a £10.50 square foot and I want it by the 5th of October, please.
The first step of making neighbours work is actually making the UK determine the value against a lower use building. Today you have a building that's using half energy to one next door, but the rent is still exactly the same. There's no difference between, so until the UK starts picking up the neighbours, and actually there's more value to a 6-star neighbours building in Australia, but there is actually to a 1 or 2 star that might be left, we're not going to go anywhere. And the minimum, the mean stuff that's coming in, it again, it's all theoretical. So you can actually change out the LED light, and all of a sudden you've got a green building, but actually it still uses twice as much energy as the building, or opposite way around. You've got a B building, B rated building, but it uses twice as much as a G. But until there's a value against this, it's not going to go hard anyway.
I think that's So I think we keep hearing neighbours is coming up. It's about performance culture, isn't it? So it's about developing a performance culture, and I'm also hearing it's not a blame culture. It is everybody's got a stake in this, the correct performance, and it's making sure we all get that. But it's no single point of failure. I think it's multiple potential points of failure. We have to share the blame, and I think rather than finger pointing, it's about getting together to do better integration.
I'm Wilson from ACOM. I like the idea of certain things, and when I said no to getting paid for results, I think we should give results. But the problem is, we really don't know who's going to be using the building and how. We've done a lot of evaluation on the same buildings, we're looking at different floors. So it's the same building, one floor can use 2 or 3 times the energy of another floor. Is that the building or is that the occupant? You can fiddle EPCs and decks to some extent, but in one sense, it's a consistent measure across the board, or it should be if you use the same software and the same person driving it, and that is a variable. But what I'm worried about is the idea of which metric we're using. Is kilowatt hours a square meter any good? Should we be using that? Because you could get your measure down, as I know some government buildings made a great ploy on decks, and they've got it from a D to a C. How did they do that? They got it back to 30% of the staff. There were less people in the same building. So you've got to have some metrics that are on about the quality of what you're delivering, not just the CO2 or an energy, and also about the usefulness of that energy in terms of the productivity of the people. I'm not sure how you actually do it, but I did school guides a number of years ago where they all wanted to know about pounds per pupil in a classroom. If you've got 30 kids in the classroom, you could heat it for £4 a pupil. If it went down to 20, it went up to £8 or £9 a pupil. You didn't have the internal gains, and you had less people to divide it by. What is the right metric? And that's what worries me when you say about one building, another building, it might be an entropy building. But one could be open from 10 in the morning to 4 because it's a charity, not working long hours. The one next door now 3 or 4 times the occupancy and a higher density. So it's feasible, exactly the same buildings, can use 10 to 1, 20 to 1. I've seen 65 to 1 differences for an identical building that's just with different occupants. So how do you put the label on the tin?
Okay,
so, I think the key point you bring up really there does come down to benchmarking and how you do the fact that when I first started to get involved with the Broadgate Estate dealing with, you know, my key client was over that way, of course it wasn't new at that point, Debbie. They used to measure everything actually also on FTE as well as actually against the square metre of the person and actually ask them a double question about why. So the degree days is quite an easy one, but it doesn't really affect actually modern buildings because of the fact that we've got, it only affects the air handling usage. Actually, when you look at it, what is the usage per FTE? Yeah. And again, I don't know if it's gone. It hasn't been picked up, it's irrelevant. It's back down to square metres. And I think maybe that's something we've got to pick up as a group. How do we influence benchmarking again? How do we get that right? How do we make that relevant and updated to reflect it? You do say kilowatt hours, only if we can measure. Because I've got a client here that asked me to save 20% carbon each year. I've done that already then. Thank you very much.
Well done, Phil, just you save another 20%. I like that though, Anne. I think one thing my colleagues who are asset managers don't understand is pounds per person. They have no idea what kilowatt hours per meter squared means, where it comes from. If you relate it to what people understand who are trying to manage these buildings, we might get a better chance. So I think there's lots to debate in this group.
We'll start to grow this family and actually work out what it is that we need to do to improve the performance of these systems in the future. So it's all about its membership, so please become members. We are probably looking for one or two committee members. If you're interested in getting on the committee, then please do approach me, come and talk to me. I'll be very happy to talk to you about that. And watch out for the future events. I think April, we have another event in April that's being...
Right. It's
group
free.
The group is free. You don't even have to be a Simsy member. So it's completely free. How's that? What better bargain could you be asking for? Thank you very much for coming along today. I do hope you'll register your interest. But thank you very much for coming along. I hope you've had a stimulating lunchtime. So thank you.